this is Leonard Nimoy, and it is my pleasure to take you on an amazing journey into a world of fantasy and adventure, the world of the Highlander. Highlander saga began in the spring of 1982.
I wrote it as a project at UCLA when I was a student there. I had gone to Scotland, and then I went down to the Tower of London in London. And if you've ever been there, they have in the basement the world's largest collection of armory. And I can remember walking through that, and I was probably 20 at the time, thinking, wow, you know, what if you owned this? I took that a step further and thought, well, what if you had actually worn all this? Then I went one step further and thought, what if you'd never died, and this is all the things you wore over the centuries?
What made the Highlander concept so unique was its ability to combine the romantic with the fantastic, creating a legend of immortality with total believability.
I always thought that one of the cool things about the movie was that all this goes on, but it could be happening to the person living next door to you.
What did he mean? There can only be one. Only one what?
The script just grabbed me right from the start because of that high adventure, that mystery, the romance.
The producers were impressed with the work of award-winning music video director Russell Mulcahy.
At that time, I was doing a lot of rock videos, you know, with Duran Duran and Queen and Elton John.
Mulcahy's personal commitment to Highlander added more than brilliant visual style and imagination.
You know, I've always been sort of fascinated in reincarnation, in the other side. I've grown up loving fantasy.
Convinced that the look of the movie would be as unique as the concept, the filmmakers turned their attention to casting the all-important role of the Highlander, Connor MacLeod.
And when I came across this person, and it was a picture of Christoph from Greystoke, and I said, this is the man. He's got eyes that seem to look into the past.
He had a quality that was sort of timeless. You believe has been around for 400 years and had the adventures, the romance, the pain, and the experience of somebody who's lived that extraordinary life.
Well, after Greystoke, The Legend of Tarzan, I was looking for another epic fantasy with a character unlike anything audiences had seen before. And I was fascinated with the idea of playing an immortal.
In Highlander, Lambert's Connor MacLeod learns of his fate from another immortal.
Greetings. I am Juan Sanchez Villalobos Ramirez, chief metallurgist to King Charles V of Spain. And I'm at your service.
What do you want?
You.
The power of Highlander worked its magic on Sean Connery.
The sensation you're feeling is the quickening.
The idea being to combine the kind of eloquence of the Egyptian and the Spanish with the sword fighting and the old codes, almost kind of this Japanese sword, a bit of everything, really. With some fun, too.
The fun Sean Connery experienced in making Highlander included his encounter with the Kurgan, played by Clancy Brown.
The Kurgan, he is the strongest of all the immortals. He is the perfect warrior. He If he wins the prize, mortal man would suffer an eternity of darkness.
How do you fight such a savage?
With heart, faith, steel. In the end, there can be only one.
The Kurgan is a great villain. I think Clancy did just a fantastic job.
Clancy walks into a room and he fills that room. And there's a tremendous physical strength. If you found this strength turned against you, it would be very unpleasant.
Clancy was so into the role, so completely the Kurgan, that he would grab me off the set and say, "Hey man, you're dead.
What do you want?"
"Your head." "And the prize."
"There can be only one."
Death does not come easily to an immortal, and the first Highlander introduced a concept that would live on in all the Highlander movies, the transfer of power called the quickening.
You read in the script, MacLeod received the quickening, and it's like, okay. But then the fun part is to work out how to visualize that, you know.
All the elements were now in place. An immortal hero, his teacher, and a villain battling across the ages for a prize.
It touched us all, not only Russell, but Christopher, Bill, myself. It was a magical time.
I very purposely tried to write a movie where you have the feeling of traveling in time, but you never travel in time. And we start in the present, we jump to the past, we come back to the present. But the characters aren't jumping time, they're living linear lives.
"You cannot die, MacLeod. Accept it." "That is a perfect way to start."
I think people hunger for a mythology that they can believe in.
"You must learn to conceal your special gift and harness your power until the time of the gathering."
"What gathering?"
"When only a few of us are left, we will feel an irresistible pull towards a faraway land to fight for the prize."
Highlander was ready to work its magic on movie audiences.
"Here we are, born to be kings, we're the princes of the universe. Here we belong, fighting to survive in a war with the darkest powers.
talk about you. People say you had Georgia.
Man, that will go far. Try the moon and reach for the stars. With my sword and head held high, got a mass of dust. First time, yeah. I know that people talk about me. I hear it every day, but I can prove it right, cause I'm right.
Queen's music just worked, and so there was a great unity with it.
In America, Highlander developed a cult status with a loyal following.
I mean, I think it's it is my favorite film. The first movie is my favorite film of all time. Even people I know who would never watch a science fiction or fantasy movie, they are interested in Highlander.
It became this phenomenal success in Europe. Huge, huge movie. I think at the time it came out, I was told it was the biggest movie in the history of France, you know, so it was like me and Jerry Lewis were geniuses in France.
In Europe, the film was an immediate success. Audiences lined up to see an expanded version with this scene never shown in America.
Everybody's dead.
Shh. I'm like you, I'm alone. Come with me, Rachel.
Whatever you say, Jack, you're the master race.
And it was unfortunate that the World War II sequence got cut, because it basically explains a whole character. I'm the blonde secretary, who you wonder, in the American version, I think, you wonder why he's so close to her. In the European and Japanese version, where that scene is in place, you realize that he saved her when she was a 12-year-old girl in World War II. And basically, she's like a daughter to him.
The stage was set for Highlander 2. With the return of original Highlander stars Christopher Lambert and Sean Connery, director Russell Mulcahy, and the participation of production designers and special effects experts from Chariots of Fire and Alien, the 1992 production of Highlander 2 took the series in a new direction. Visually, I think it's probably got some outstanding sequences in it, probably even more so than the first one. Let's say, for example, the flying battle scene.
Blades. Yes. Flying blades. Blades.
I thought visually it was incredible.
Highlander soon-to-be-released laser-disc version of Highlander 2 will include this sequence never shown in America.
Hey, McCarr!
Most of the fighting themselves, and some of it got really quite hairy. There was less use of stuntmen than one would think.
The elevator was just fun. I'm not saying I wasn't scared, because I was, being 75 or 80 feet up in the air on the roof of an elevator.
Every shot you see of the elevator is Chris Lambert.
Highlander 2 was an even greater success, convincing the producers that the saga would not be complete without a final chapter, a fitting conclusion to its hero's epic adventures, requiring a script as unique and memorable as the original.
I could feel a kind of power. This one had the magic, the story, the villain that could finally equal the Kurgan. And it was right for the fans. It was right for me. It was the direct sequel to number one.
In December of 1993, production began on Highlander, The Final Dimension, continuing the fate of Connor MacLeod established in the original Highlander, placing him and the story firmly on Earth, beginning his final journey in Japan 400 years ago.
I've got a new mentor who's teaching me different things.
Nothing is what it seems, Highlander.
Into this world comes my most evil enemy, Kane, an immortal from hell.
Some say he's the devil himself.
Played by Mario Van Peebles. I haven't flossed in years. Kane and MacLeod first clash in the cave of the magician Nakano, an immortal with the power of illusion.
Kane receives the sorcerer's unlimited powers of illusion, unleashing a maelstrom of unstoppable evil, challenging the Highlander's spirit, and taking the saga one step beyond into the final dimension.
In 1994, a team of archaeologists discovered a cave. By doing that, they released the immortal.
Director Andy Morahan is employing his own award-winning music video techniques to create a visual style that updates the concept to 1995. And because The Final Highlander is both the direct sequel and the conclusion to the original, the producers insisted on a filmmaker with a background similar to the director of the first Highlander.
If we can bring a visual side together with the story, then hope to get the best of both worlds.
In this Highlander, the final battle between immortals rages over four centuries, challenging the production designers with 60 different sets in locations as diverse as 18th century France, Morocco, Scotland, New York, and 17th century Japan.
One of the themes that runs through this is a sort of nightmarish quality, partly to do with living forever. There's a very romantic edge about being an immortal.
MacLeod's courage to love is tested when Alex Johnson, an archaeologist played by Deborah Unger, is drawn into the Highlander's life.
I know who you are. You're Connor MacLeod. Born into the clan MacLeod.
It's great. It runs the gamut of everything. There's some terrific emotional scenes.
Whatever you saw nothing. You don't know what you're getting yourself into.
There are also some very exciting action pieces that I get to participate in, some willingly, some not so willingly.
Highlander, the final dimension, constantly makes physical demands on its stars, especially in this unique sword fight conceived and choreographed by director Andy Moorhead. It all comes to an unforgettable conclusion on January 27th, 1995, with explosive and startling special effects. A stunning and surprising climax to the Highlander saga, Highlander, the Final Dimension, will be released in theaters across America, fulfilling the hopes of all those whose lives were changed by Highlander I. Highlander, the Final Dimension. This is Leonard Nimoy. It has been my pleasure to take you on an amazing journey into a world of fantasy and adventure. The world of The Highlander.